I want to do a quick follow-up to my latest upload on Backlash Channel, which involved the blogger's post that I had read regarding what he referred to as fake victims. And in my upload, I just mentioned fake victims under a generalized category, although this person who uploaded his blog was highlighting specifically what he saw as a easing of personal responsibility in our society as it related to people who essentially just gorged themselves into becoming ultra hefty huge whales and then for whatever purpose claim to be having a victim status and end up as a result of this being subjected to things like wheelchairs or getting special treatment as far as they're being labeled having a disability what all. And of course, I didn't go into any personal details or offer any additional caveats or anything, such as saying that, well, one of the reasons that these people are getting hyper-obese and whatnot, and once they're restricted to a wheelchair, like I said, you know, there are so many different facets to things like that to where I didn't really want to delve into some of the reasons as to why somebody might be in that situation. But ultimately, as the main point that was really being made was that it doesn't matter what gets you there, it's what you do once you're there. And so the whole issue had to deal with the whole aspect of personal accountability and personal responsibility, and that was pretty much the main points that I was kind of wanting to highlight in that post. And I felt that the blogger essentially said it in a way that would be an attention grabber and would at the same time focus on what the issue was and what needs to be focused on and have some sort of attention paid to it. Now, as I was recording that commentary and reading off of that, well, it wasn't during my commentary portion of it, because again, my commentary was more or less left open-ended, but as I was reading the blog post verbatim, I was doing all of that while my fiance was here in the same room doing her little thing on her laptop, and so she was essentially just kind of like listening to my speech, as it were, until I had pretty much completed what I was going to be uploading. And as soon as I had concluded with that, then she pretty much went in as far as her personal opinions on all this. And the main thing with her was that she took major issue with the blogger's language and some of the disrespectful terminology that he was using and some of the very dehumanizing language that he was using in expressing himself about these things that he took an issue with. And not to want to excuse that as a legitimate point, but at the same time, I kind of felt that I had a missed opportunity in that particular recording, in that I probably should have projected a little bit more deeply into it and pulled that out as something that I could have incorporated into it as far as how this man was expressing himself, and weighing that as part of the whole option of what he was trying to say. But maybe it's best that that particular recording got to be a standalone, so that as I come in with a follow-up, that maybe we could reflect a little bit more on his quote-unquote attitude, if you will, about these situations. Because here's how I look at it, and it's a cruel double-edged sword as far as I see it. On the one hand, you recognize, of course, the man was being disrespectful. His point is probably going to have a lot harder time getting through to the people to whom such a point needs to be made. And as Jeannie Burlesque stated in her comment on the previous video, I highlighted this one phrase that she made, which pretty much sums up the whole thing, which is, quote, "In my world, complaints are meant to lead to solutions, not just more complaints," unquote. And I read that little statement by Jeannie, and that just pretty much sums up what this whole gender war thing has been all about. As disrespectful as it is, as backbiting as it is, as much fur that flies around in it, I've always stated that, look, these are not people who are hating just to be hating, even though they come at it a lot of times with some nasty viciousness. I made the statement that if you actually listen to the complaints that people are making in regard to this thing, you'll recognize, if we're honest with ourselves, we'll recognize that there are some real legitimate problems that need to be addressed and some concerns that need to be focused upon in order for us to change our behavior. Notice, I didn't say that for the other person to change their behavior, but to change our behavior. And the reason I say that is because this whole thing goes hand in hand. It's one hand washing the other. It's the complaints of black women about black men that are legitimate. And it's the complaints about black men about black women, which are legitimate. And so, since we have a mutual view of this fact that there's something within the black community or within the black culture that is keeping us at odds with one another as far as our intimate relationships go, the problem is we're so frustrated and we're so angered and we've just have so much indignation because we just don't see things going the way that they should be going, that our outlet is to express this indignation. And even if we are doing so in a way that tries to offer solutions, it still comes across as, oh, you're just angry, you're just bitter, oh, you're just being a hater, or whatever the catchphrase of the day that they're using. And I stated from the very beginning, and when I got in on this originally, it was to be sort of a backup to Sergeant Willie Pete, who saw that, you know, how popular his speech was, it effectively got him banned off of this particular upload site. But I tried to come to his defense, and not just his defense, but also to the defense of primarily black men. I'll acknowledge that, because again, as I stated before, ours was the only voice that was not being heard, and suddenly we had an outlet. And as a result of that, it stings your ass when you find out that once you throw something out in response to somebody who's been throwing it at you the whole time with total impunity, then it typically doesn't go over very well. So, with that said, as long as anybody actually listened to me, they saw that I was about balance. I said, look, we both have issues, we both have legitimate complaints, and we both have areas where we both need to work on. And I always summed it up, as saying that in order for things to really, really change, it has to start with the black woman, not because it's the black woman's fault per se, but because it's the black men's fault. Because we're so weak and we're so not inclined to be the people of character that we're supposed to be, that we just give in to the lackadaisical whims of our black women who just say, hey, mediocrity is okay, and so you don't have to strive for excellence. And black men being weak in that sense, wanting the easiest trek from point A to point Z, they just simply say, well, hey, I don't have to put forth the extra work or do all the character building things that a man needs to do, a man must do. If she's going to accept me as being some lowdown or some just, you know, never do well or just a brush off whatever kind of person, then, hey, that's all the effort I need to expend. I'm good. I don't need to better myself or to be a shining example for anything. And so I always stated that that's our fault as men. So ultimately, we're to be held accountable for the dejected state that the African American community is in. Granted, again, the source of the problem is the black woman, but the problem ultimately is the black man. Because were we men of character as we should be, it wouldn't matter what our women did. It would just be a matter of, like, no, sister, before I pay any attention to you, you got to get your stuff together. You've got to demand better for yourself. And if you're not going to demand better for yourself, then I'll go across the fence to some other group of women who don't typically demand better of their men. And so, as a result of nobody listening, and as a result of nobody actually trying to make any changes, we get these attitudes, such as the one that was presented by this blogger, which says, and he himself said it, is like, look, I'm not beating up on these people because I think they're nasty or I think they're disgusting or anything, but I'm just so frustrated
at this whole hands-off attitude. Like, you can't complain about somebody who doesn't take personal responsibility for themselves and then expect the whole world to just fall at their feet and placate them and smooch up to them and say, it's like, oh, they're their baby, it's not your fault, when clearly it is their fault. So I get that from this blogger, that yeah, there's a lot of frustration that's involved. And again, as I said, we see it here in the African-American community as it relates to this black gender war. It's the same sort of principle. We're just getting so frustrated at this whole thing about us not really wanting to work together, not wanting to acknowledge that we have problems that we need to work on both sides of the equation, that it turns into essentially a bitch fest, and where everybody's just launching some of the most nasty, the most mean, most vicious, hateful terminology and whatever that we can toss at. And part of it, yes, clearly, part of it is to hurt the other person. I get that. I acknowledge it. But as I stated from the very, very, very beginning, if we can learn to overlook all the hateful language, all the bitterness, all the intense emotion that comes with these things, and filter all that stuff out, toss it away as chaff, and look at the whole grain of what you've got left, the real kernels of knowledge and wisdom that's actually settled inside of all this extra stuff, and you focus on the real concerns and on the real message, then ultimately there's your opportunity to say, hey, we've got legitimate complaints, we've got legitimate concerns, and because of these complaints, because of these concerns, what can we do to fix that so that we can be perceived better in the eyes of those who have an issue with us or an issue with what we do. And that's always been my case in point. And so, in a sense, I'm kind of glad that this that I did focus on this blogger's entry, because of the fact that it kind of helps. I'm hoping that it will help just to better understand where a lot of the anger and a lot of the bitterness comes from, and to maybe say, okay, let's focus on this for a while. Let's deal with the whole issue about, oh, you're not, you know, really attracting the kind of people, or you're not really getting them to acknowledge their problems because you're just being mad and evil and nasty and vicious and bitter about it. But what do you think that frustration comes from? You think that somebody just decided, like, oh, I don't like big fat black women with attitude, so I'm just going to go out there and scream and holler and yell about big fat black women with attitude as the this, that, and the other? Or does the frustration come from the fact it's like, hey, we tried to explain it, we tried to be real about it, we tried to be respectable and respectful about it, and their response is, oh, nigga, go away, and blah, 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 and the same thing on the vice versa end of the spectrum. Black women, there was a time when black women tried to get through to us. There are still a lot of black women up here that try to get through to us on an intellectual level. But then when we come back at them, it's like, oh, you bitch, you single baby mama, and you probably fat and ugly, and you in your 30s and never had a man. And so, you know, how are they going to supposed to respond when they're pouring their hearts out and they're trying to say, hey, maybe we have a solution to your problem, and then all they get is denial too? So this is what's keeping us apart. Everybody's in this sense of my shit don't stink, self-delusion and denial. And so after a while, the people who really do care, who do give a damn, who want to try to see things better and offer solutions, this is why I was explaining to V. Marie. I say, sister, I appreciate what you're trying to do. I see where you're trying to go with this. You're only setting yourself up for major disappointment because nobody will listen. And that's the key. When we learn to listen, then and only then can we actually start making the positive changes that we need to make in order to fix our shit. Until then, don't expect any changes to actually come through from all of our intense involvement in all this. All we can really expect anymore is just more vitriol, more nastiness, more in back and forth fighting, and everybody walking away into their own little corner with these heaving, you know exactly what I'm talking about, so I don't need to even go any further about that. So that's my assessment on the whole thing. Yeah, it could have been handled differently, no doubt, but there's a reason for such frustration. And if we only look at our own experience as far as this black gender war goes, then we can only acknowledge that We are our own worst enemy. End of line.